following is a special presentation of TNN Motorsports. The champ is cooking. The kid is gunning for a title. Intentions in the air. It's funny car crunch time as the flop top pack is down to three contenders for the crown. Seven-time titleist John Forrest is barely ahead of sophomore sensation Ron Capps, while Chuck Etchells needs an eight-week hot streak to stay alive in the Winston chase. Winning the U.S. Nationals 2 weeks ago put John Forrest narrowly in the funny car points lead over Ron Capps. Who should Capps race first round earlier today but Forrest's hit man, Tony Pendragon? Could the assassin do his job? Ford versus Chevy, the crowd loving it, and the answer was yes. Ford beat Chevy as Capps crosses the center line and Tony pounds out a 5-16. Disappointed but still determined, that's Ron Capps.
I didn't want to come back and I had the wheel turned and at that point I knew I was close either hitting it or about to hit it, and it at that point I gave it a pedal, but I think I hit the cone already, and it's all right. We'll bounce back, believe me.
On John Force's final qualifying effort, he shocked the field by grabbing the number one qualifying spot at a 4.93. Would he be able to shock us again in round number one when he squared off with Jack Wyatt? Wyatt would produce nothing. He smokes the tires as Force rumbles down the quarter mile. 4.90. A great start once again for the new points leader, proving that gold is good again.
I'm really excited to bring this action car out here, gold from Indy, and run it. And we slipped our other body over on Tony's car. I got to apologize to Castrol Syntech because they got the bodies confused. He's supposed to drive the other one. But good feeling for all the fans. And Hot Rod, she's starting to talk now. Conditions are real good here. Got a ceiling up here. So don't know what to say. I'm just really excited. The point still looks really good. Tell Betty everything will be okay.
And the Kendall gang were all on hand to cheer for Chuck Etchells, a fixture here for two decades, fighting for his points alongside Randy Anderson in Randy's newly Jim Dunn-tuned Pontiac. With an 0.08 qualifying advantage for favorite Etchells, the right lane was a choice that bucked him around at the start, but ultimately roared him to victory with a 4.99.
That is the best performance out of this car in some time at 4.99, 303.
Well, I'll tell you, General and Kim, they make it happen. Old Team Kendall, Super Winch, Mama Rosa's Pizza, they give us the money and we just got some performance.
That was pretty close to a perfect run, Chuck, at 499, 303.
Well, you know, it's been leaving soft lately. We've been struggling with that. We're giving up a lot at the hit, a lot at 60 feet, and maybe he's finding something in that, in that area.
Sure did work.
Now you know how two of the three combatants did in the battle for the championship. They were winners. We'll look at more when we come back on TNN. From beautiful Maple Grove Raceway, just outside of Reading, Pennsylvania, it's the Pioneer Keystone Nationals on TNN Motorsports. A jam-packed crowd on hand as they sit back and get set for all the final rounds. We're going to set the stage and bring you those finals right here today. Let's get some more information from down in the pit area and Steve Evans.
If it's news you want, it's news you get. And you're right about the tremendous crowds, and also they have been enjoying great weather, very conducive to racing. How about Top Fuel qualifying? Gary Selzy carried his Indy momentum into Maple Grove. A 4.55 track record took the pole Friday night, just 200s off the national mark. Joe Amato plugged crew member and test driver Bill Walsh into a second Tenneco car. Blocker Bill got the 15th spot with one pass at 4.72. And finally, points leader Corey Mack, well, he couldn't match Selzy. His 4.65 good only for the second spot. Dave Reap, what's the haps in funny car?
Well, Steve, the very first year the funny car points were ever contested, the only blemish in Don Perdomo's year, one round loss. He won by more than 6,000 points. While John Force has been dominant in the 90s, we will not see anything like that again. The top three, Ron Capps, John Force, Chuck Etchells, they're neck and neck and neck as we go down the stretch. Speaking of down the stretch, John Force was scheduled to debut a 1999 Mustang, but the NHRA said, no, no, no. That setback has Force focused on championship number 8. For the facts in Factory Hot Rod, here's Laura Bird.
And Dave, they are hot rods this weekend. Never was the parity in pro stock more evident than now. With all 16 cars qualified in the 6-second range, a very quick field, and one that includes both the Collins cars, driven by Sean and Richie, a huge achievement for that team. and achievements high on the minds of both Jake Coughlin and Kurt Johnson, who are locked in a battle for second place in the Winston points behind the leader, Orrin Johnson. You know, despite it all, Bob, there's still lots of hot competition in pro stock.
It's going to be a great day right here at Maple Grove Raceway for those in attendance at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals and for those of you at home watching right here on TNN Motorsports. We got a lot of cash up for grabs here today between the cash prize of almost $650,000 and the contingency put up by the NHRA sponsors on the tour. We got about $1,600,000 up for grabs, and these fans are just waiting to see who is going to take home the lion's share of that here today. And a lot of the interest focused on the fuel classes, battles in both Top Fuel and Funny Car. Let's take a look at that Funny Car ladder. You know, of course, that there were three of the drivers in advance. And also, we had Dell Worshman, Big Al in the opening round, the John Costanza car with Tim Wilkerson against the Pioneer, the sponsor car here in opening round competition. Over on the flip side, Bazemore's over there, and that's Bob Wygenant, local guy, trying to make good. Scusa and Epler, who doesn't have the Chevy, and Cruz with the school teacher, Gary Densham, in the opening round of competition. Let's go back and take a look at some of the other round number one highlights. We told you that Pioneer's the sponsor. They got a new look, all new colors, new logo. That meant a week's worth of work for Tom Hoover's guys to get their car ready. And Tim Wilkerson in the John Costanza car, the guy that will always tell you, I should have won Indy 98. Well, he should have won round one at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals in 98 also, but he didn't. Hoover goes 5-19 and takes the new-look Pioneer car into round number two. Another matchup, it's Gary Densham in the NEC car from AAA in Southern California. Been a very good year for Gary, but he keeps getting some of those big, nasty cars in the opening round. Bruce Pedregon only qualified in the number six spot with the Joe Gibbs Interstate Batteries car, but in round one, look out, 4-98. For Cruz Pedregon, Gary Densham fired a 5.65, but it just wasn't enough. So the opening round over, it would make round number two some very good matchups, including Force and Worsham, and Hoover advanced along with Tony Pedregon off of that side of the ladder. On the B side, we didn't show you Whit Bazemore, but he had a good opening round, 5.01 win. Chuck Echols would be his opponent, and Dean Scusa ran 5.13 to get around a tire-smoking Jim Epler. Laura Bird's got some more stuff for us in the pit area. Let's check in with her right now.
Well, Dell Worsham might feel like he's starring in the movie Groundhog Day, because for the second time, he just made the field, qualifying in the last session. Dell, what is going on?
I'll tell you what, this year, this event, it was more self-induced than it was just having bad luck. We tried some new stuff. We're getting ready for next year and just had to go back to our old stuff to get qualified.
And some people are saying it's Dell and Goliath, because up against John Force for the second time in 2 weeks, this kid's going to have to slay a giant.
Oh, yeah. He says, bring on Force. I can take him. We're going to find out here in just a little bit. And we'll take a look back at round number one of an explosive Top Fuel Eliminator, plus the pro stocks and the bikes, all coming up from the Pioneer Keystone Nationals.
TNN's exclusive coverage of the 14th annual Pioneer Keystone Nationals is brought to you by Mopar, Chrysler Corporation parts, and the Chrysler, Plymouth, Dodge, Jeep, and Eagle dealers who sell and install them. And by Miller Lite, who reminds you that every Miller Lite is sold ready to drink. And by Castrol Syntec, the active lubricant.
The ground rumbles, the air thunders, and nitro fills stands of fans leaping to their feet for a Winston championship at the Boiling Point. Will it be Corey Mack, Gary Selzy, or Joe Amato that cooks the competition? Top Fuel is next.
Top Fuel is what NHRA Winston Drag Racing's all about. Corey Mack leads the points. He is just that far. One round. That's what 20 points equals. Ahead of Gary Selzy, Joe Amato in striking distance, and Mike Dunn, who hasn't won a race all year but keeps going rounds, right there in striking distance in the four hole, and the 96 champion Kenny Bernstein also in the top five. Top 10 rounded out by Bruce Sarver, the independent, running very well, and he performed well again here at Maple Grove. Now let's take a look at that opening round ladder. Of course, the number one car, Gary Selzy, gets a great opportunity here, you would think, against the number 16 car, but Bob Vandegrift Jr. checked into the 16 slot, and that is a 450 race car. Fans here at Maple Grove, of course, just love the drag racing here on TNN. In addition to that Selzy-Vandegrift matchup, Kenny Bernstein with a tough encounter with Doug Coletta. Look at Jim Head, his best qualifying effort in a long while, especially when you figure he didn't qualify at Indy. Eddie Hill continues to qualify well. Can he do well on Sunday? There's the blocker, Bill Walsh. Corey Mack against Sarver as advertised. Dunn against Pat Dagan, who went to the finals here a couple of years ago. Then Amato, tough first-round draw against Larry Dixon. Back in round number one, this is Bruce Sarver. That is Corey Mack, the big red machine, the McDonald's car, who has been in the points lead virtually from the start. Once Jim Head abdicated the top spot, but Sarver certainly not a gimme in the opening round. Sarver smokes him, and Corey smokes him. Corey gets the win with a good 4.69 elapsed time.
Well, you heard a motor, but what the heck? A 4.69 gets you through round one.
Yeah, I don't care if we're at four motors, as long as they make it to the final day and keep up with Selzy and Amato. But once again, I mean, you can't take them for granted, anybody. Sarver's been awesome lately, running 59 at Indy and run 60, you know, 60s here. I mean, it's just fantastic. And Ted's going to be an awesome crew chief, you know, but just got to take one at a time.
Great job.
The Ted he talked about, Ted Fashion. There's the crew chief on Team Winston, Alan Johnson. This team is certifiably hot. Opening round, they got Bob Vandergriff Jr., the Jersey's car. Certainly not a gimme. This car's been in the 450s before. Wow. Slight advantage Vandergriff off the line, but Selzy just did run him down.
Bob Vandergriff gave you everything.
Well, there's no doubt. As soon as I shut it off, Bob was there, and I didn't know who won. And one of these smart alecks on the wall gave me the thumbs down, and I just about puked in my helmet.
Don't be doing that.
Don't you hate those smart alecks? Dave Reese in the pit area of one of the homeboys here.
It was 1990 when a wild-eyed surfer dude from California decided to pick up and move to the Keystone State to drive the infamous Snickers funny car. Today, Mike Dunn is still in Pennsylvania, and he's still driving behind the wheel of Daryl Gwynn's Mopar Top Fuel Dragster. They've been running great, too. Two consecutive final round appearances. It ain't exactly surfing, but it still is a great wave they're riding and would like to continue here.
Yeah, you don't find a lot of folks that move to Pennsylvania for the surfing. The commercial metal fabricator's machine, Pat Dakin, Tom Cattleman. They had Mark Oswald helping out at Indy. This is a pretty good race car against Dunn in the opening round. The onboard camera shot, you saw Mike Dunn pull ahead. 465 did beat Pat Dakin's 478. And it would be Joe Amato, the Tenneco Automotive Tom Fueler against Larry Dixon. Been a tough year for the Dixon team. Struggled just to qualify here, but finally did get into the field, but only in number 11 spot. Dixon was out on Amato, breaks the rear end of the car, slows, and Amato dodges one, gets the win at 487.
Yeah, I know, the car went in, my helmet was fogging up on me, and I was trying to not breathe, and it threw my concentration off a little bit, but it will take a win. You know, sometimes you're better to be lucky than good.
How about that? Joe Amato maybe living right. It's Selzy against Bernstein, your last two Winston champs, and a couple of former Indy champs, Jim Head and Eddie Hill, as they will match up. Interesting side of the ladder. Kristen Powell advanced as she tattooed Bill Walsh in a tire smoker. She gets Corey and Dunn and Amato, a couple of guys to call Pennsylvania home. We'll go at it in round number two. And let me tell you, that Dunn Mopar team machine has been hot of late. The fans absolutely loving the action here. It's been a great couple of days from qualifying till today. And of course, we got the finals coming up in just a bit. A lot of these folks will love Motor Madness on TNN on Friday night. They'll see the greatest show on dirt this week. The Pennzoil World of Outlaws do battle in the Cornhusker Outlaw Showdown. See it live Friday night, 8 p.m. Eastern, right here on TNN's Motor Madness. We had a chance to talk with a lot of the drivers here and ask them, what would you do if you weren't racing? God forbid. Here's what Kenny Bernstein had to say.
Oh, I'm sure I'd still be in the restaurant business, and I'd be putting together those hot pastrami sandwiches and pickles and chips, baby, because it was a pretty good business, but it was a tough one. But fortunately, motorsports took me out of that.
Since this top fuel battle is so intense, we figured we'd ask some of the drivers who they think the favorites are.
I don't like to pick people, but I'm going to pick Corey because he's such a good guy. He's worked so hard in the past, and he's just had such a handful of bad luck. I think he's really doing well. He's getting the points lead down, and you know, he's always the bridesmaid, so I think he's going to be the bride this year.
If I had to pick one of those three and say they're going to win it, and it wasn't us, the Budweiser King, I probably lean towards Selzy at this time because they seem to have the momentum going right now.
If you look at it, it looks like Selzy's the one that's making the run at the end of the season. Everybody else has had their shot. You know, Corey was early on, and then Amato had his time, and now it seems like Selzy.
It's got to be Gary Selzy and Alan Johnson. They won last year. They really won the year before also. So this will be a three-peat for them as far as I'm concerned. They're the guys to beat. They always have been.
Well, to be real honest about it, I don't care. I know it's not going to be us. I know that we can make those guys' life miserable, and that's our intentions.
I like Ed McCauley. He's nothing if not honest. Hey, man, if we can't win it, hey, pretzels, get your pretzels. You want mustard on that, son? Just don't put your nose against the glass. Great crowd on hand here at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals Maple Grove Raceway just outside of Reading, Pennsylvania. Let's take a look back at round two and see how the combatants did. Selzy, Amato, Corey in the battle for top fuel supremacy. Eddie Hill would be first up against Jim Head. How about Jim Head? Failed to qualify at Indy, made the field with a great number four shot right here, looking to go to the semis. And he would. 4.75 as Eddie smoked the tires, and Jim Head's enjoying one of his best days since the first two races of the year.
Oh, the ebb and flow of this sport. Jim, you couldn't qualify at Indy just 2 weeks ago, and here you go to the semifinals at the Grove.
No doubt 2 weeks ago, Steve, was the low point of my career, winning it last year in DNQ and this year, and this thing's running pretty good. I hope we don't lose it.
A 4.75.
No, that stinks. I don't know what's going on. The air's getting worse, and we're chasing it, and we're obviously not chasing it quick enough.
He's not doing badly, though. Let's go for more Top Fuel news. Here's David Reeve.
Well, after winning... With the top four drivers in the Winston Top Fuel points chase all moving on to round number two, the likelihood of Kenny Bernstein winning the Top Fuel championship begins to get a little bit dimmer. But that doesn't mean he can't play the role of spoiler, and that's just what he'll do with lane choice against Gary Selzy in round number two.
You can tell by the look on Selzy's face. He goes, what? We ran 4.65 and didn't get lane choice? Bernstein did with a 4.64 on board the Budweiser King of Kenny Bernstein. On board, you can see Selzy, 4.62, 307 miles an hour, a brilliant pass for Team Winston. Great look at one of those 6,000 horsepower engines in Joe Amato's car, the Tenneco Automotive Top Fueler. That's Bill Walsh on the left. He was the blocker here today. Good theory, didn't work. Joe getting set, he has never won here at Maple Grove, the track that he calls home. He's got the red-hot Mike Dunn in Darrell Gwynn's Team Mopar entry here in the near lane. Smoke on both sides of the racetrack. Mike Dunn gets the win, 4.65 at 3.06.
You know, I'm disappointed. You know, it's one of these deals. I want to win this race before I retire. I guess I can never retire until I win this race. But, you know, we just have to hope for the best on the points and see what happens.
Nobody wants you to retire. You're much too young.
Went to the finals here in 85 and lost to Big Daddy Don Garland. Has not been able to win at Maple Grove. Kristen Powell's Reebok car, 450 race car again. Could she take out the guy that she said she thinks is going to win it all? Almost, but not quite. Kristen runs a 4.66, but Corey goes 4.61. Lowy T of the round. Great crowd on hand getting set for the semifinals that we'll show you in just a bit. Selzy against Jim Head. Good friends, Jim Head and the entire Johnson family. And over on the flip side, it is going to be Corey Mack against Mike Dunn. Let's go to the pit area and another update on Top Fuel with Dave Reeve.
Well, Bob, and Gary Selzy's quest to win three events in a row, he's through to the semifinals. The good news is Joe Amato's off your back, so you can breathe easy about that. But Corey Mack is keeping pace, and Jim Head is definitely one of those cars you can't take lightly.
Jim Head is definitely one of those cars you can't take lightly. You know, last night, Jim bought both teams dinner and at a very nice restaurant, and he insisted on buying. And there's a lot of bragging rights that go on between the two teams. And, yeah, Allen helps Jim Head, but he's not helping him on this round. And believe me, if we lose this round, I don't know if we can live with him.
Well, believe me, Alan Johnson's already taking a look at the computer, see if they can duplicate that 460 to take out their good friend. Bob?
The way the weather is changing here, it's going to take a 460 if you want to win, and unless, of course, you have a car that's that size. We got more coming up, including funny car stuff from Maple Grove next.
TNN's exclusive coverage of the 14th annual Pioneer Keystone Nationals is brought to you by the more than 2,500 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts.
The funny car folks are all chasing that guy. He's one of the chasers. Who do the drivers think will win it all?
I'm not putting Edsel's down, but I think it's going to be a race between Caps and Force.
Well, I think it's going to be John Force. He isn't a seven-time champion for nothing. And him and Austin and Medlin and Bernie, they have their best is yet to come.
And I'm a good friend of Chuck Etchell's, and I'd love to see him do well. But and you just can't count out John Force with his resources. If you look back at the season, you can see what Cruz has done. And, I mean, that's an awesome car, but he's made a couple mistakes that's knocked him out. Caps has made a few. You know, he's new at this. The media pressure got to him at Indy, apparently, according to what he said. So, you know, you got to focus all that out. Force has been there, and Force is real hungry.
If I can help any one of them except Force, I'll do my best to do that. If we can get our car running straight and I can be a spoiler, it'd make the rest of my year.
Mr. Warmth, Al Hoffman. Folks love to watch him race here at this racetrack. He's had some wild passes. Let's see how the contenders and contendees did back in round number two earlier today. It would be Whit Bazemore, Team Winston Chevrolet, Chuck Echols, the Mama Rosa Pizza, Chevrolet, by way of Team Kendall, and Super Winch. Two good Chevrolet funny cars. Whit Bazemore, first out of the gate by a bunch, is 5:03, beats and hurts. Etchell's losing 5:01. Ouch.
The only bad thing about this round is I just did John Force a favor by taking Etchell's out. But we had to do it for ourselves, for our own team, of course, Team Winston Chevy Camaro. I saw Etchell's right there at the end, just passed me. I thought, man, it must have been close. But Rob and my guys are doing an outstanding job.
We will watch that again from the onboard camera in the Kendall car for Chuck Etchells. His reaction time was 5:74, and that killed him.
I just told Whit I kind of left on his motor a little bit. I was staging. I had a lot of nitro come in there, and I knew I was in trouble. And I said, I'm trying to stay sharp and stay focused, and I lost my focus. It's that simple. You know, I mean, I could see where I was going, so I could see a light, or supposed to.
When you own the car and you drive it, it's tough to blame anybody else, and Chuck didn't. Tom Hoover, new-look Pioneer car, his future driver, Corey Lee, out in front. Tony Pendragon, he doesn't have the black body, that's in the pits. Force doesn't have the white body, that's on Tony's car. John's got the gold body. Hope you're taking notes. We'll have a quiz after the show. Tony Pendragon gets the win at 5:05, doing what the boss pays him to do, taking out guys and going rounds. Hoover ran a good 5:34, but not enough. Dale Worsham, the Checkers, Chucks, Kragen car. Couple of races in a row, a couple of semifinals. Looking to go to the semis for the third time in a row. All he's got to do, take out the gold car. Seven-time Winston champ, John Ford. Could he do it? Nope. Forrest, 5-flat, beats a game effort. 5:14 by Dale Worsham, but not quite good enough. And Cruz Pendragon. Never can tell what kind of numbers this bad boy will throw out. The Interstate Batteries machine up against Dean Scusa on board. Team Mopar, the Matco Tools machine. Been almost a year since Scusa won down in Houston. Oh, baby. Cruz was a day late and a dollar short. Scusa, 5:08. Beach Cruz is 5:09. He was 2 tenths quicker out of the gate. Wow. pairings going into the final four. It'll be Force and Tony Pedregon. Care to place your bets? Whit Bazemore, Dean Scusa. Ought to be a great matchup. Two very good, strong cars. Scusa has lane choice. Whit Bazemore down the pit area, standing by with our Laura Bird.
Well, he's not standing by, Bob, but I can tell you something. He's concentrating very hard on what he wants to do because he's not in the habit of making John Force's job easier. But since that's what he's done, that favor could turn into an opportunity. If he can blast past Dean Scusa, a guy he's already beaten three times this year, and get himself into the final against, you guessed it, either Tony Pedregon or the man, John Force, then he'll have an opportunity he might not have thought he'd had earlier. Be careful what you ask for. You just might get it, Bob.
So I never ask for anything. The folks here are asking for some great finals. They're going to see Force and Tony here in just a little bit. It's going to be interesting, along with that Witt-Scusa matchup. Hey, you know, there's always a lot going on in Hazard County. And for a daily help in a race and romance in Roscoe P. Coltrane, don't miss the Dukes of Hazard. See it weekdays at 5 Eastern right here on America's Country Home, TNN. We're going to take a look at one of the funny car drivers. Wonder what Tony Pedregon would be doing if he weren't driving. Probably be a model or something like that. What do you think?
Well, besides racing, I still enjoy just being somewhat artistic. A big hobby of mine is still designing and painting a lot of helmets. I've done a lot of race cars, a lot of tractor trailers, but just like to concentrate on the helmets. And I'm actually considering, besides racing, at the same time opening up a shop to do just...
One of the really interesting things about coming to Maple Grove, the juxtaposition with a quiet, bucolic countryside that is nearby. And some great picture opportunities, too. That's the bridges of Moton County. I'm not sure Moton's a county, but that's the name of the town. Go with me on this, will you? These folks did. We're going to take a look at some great action in Funny Car semifinals at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. This has turned out to be one of the great races on the NHRA Winston Tour, dating back to the year in 85 when Tim Gross first pulled a stunning upset to win in Funny Car right now. We are on board with Dean Scusa, the Matco Tools Dodge Avenger, looking to go to the finals for the third time this year. He's got Team Winston, Whit Bazemore, Chevrolet, out looking for some sponsor help for next year. Hey, a win at the Grove would look good on your resume. But it's not going to happen. Too much smoke for Team Winston and Dean Scusa. The winner at 5:07, he goes to the finals again. Other semifinal, you know, this isn't a gimme. Force and Tony have run five times this year. John's won three. Tony won twice, including that classic, maybe historic final down in Houston. John's got the gold car. And John will get the win and the lane choice. 5:01, good enough, as he'll go into the championship round against that pesky Dean Scusa. Steve?
Well, Bob, they have just warmed up John Force's car for that battle against Scusa, and I'll tell you, they may have got it on the Richter scale. It was shaking the ground. And, John, you got dealt a couple of aces here this weekend, a great racetrack and cloud cover. You didn't need all the downforce.
Well, yeah, that's really critical. You know, it's kind of like NASCAR. You know, there's tracks Gordon can run on, and there's tracks that Earnhardt or Rusty can run on, and Memphis is going to be tough for us. We got to make all the points we can here and now.
Scusa wants you so bad.
Well, we want him. We need that extra round, and we got a blessing there with Tony taking caps out, so we'll just see.
We will see. Dave Reith.
Indeed, Dean Scusa does want John Force. Just like Chief Wahoo, he'd love to scalp the seven-time champ in the final. This is a big race. You've been waiting for this for a long, long time.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's finally coming together here. We've been having all kinds of mechanical problems the last six races, and you know, we've been in some finals this year, but with never really the feeling of confidence that we could pull it out. Hopefully, we learned enough here this weekend with the new components we put on, and we could take them out. That'd be nice.
Downforce, traction, power, who cares about all that stuff? It's been since Houston last year, since he's taken the win. He definitely wants number two here today, Bob.
I just want to correct something John Force said, by the way. John, Jeff Gordon can run on any track. Scusa and Force getting set to go at it. Kind of a nip and tuck deal. And I'll tell you what, I like the Cleveland Indians baseball. I like Dean Scusa coming here in the finals. So do a lot of these folks here at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals.
TNN's exclusive coverage of the 14th annual Pioneer Keystone Nationals is brought to you by Mopar, Chrysler Corporation Parts, and the Chrysler, Plymouth, Dodge, Jeep, and Eagle dealers who sell and install them.
Bob Fry, along with Laura Bird, Dave Reif, Steve Evans, and thousands of loyal NHRA Winston drag racing fans at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals getting ready for the finals. Let's take you back and look at the semis in Top Fuel. Team Winston on a roll. Alan Johnson, close friends with Jim Head. Jim Head hasn't looked this good since he went to the finals of the first two races of the 98 season, and he was the points leader. He'd give it a shot, a car length shy. However, Selzy, 462, beats Jim Head's 473. Team Winston, three in a row in the finals. Jerry Gwynn, Darrell's on hand. Team Mopar, the Top Fuel machine, getting set to go. They hosted Michelle Baines, an injured racer in their pits, and Mike Dunn said, Michelle, I'm going to win this one for you. And you know what? He just might. Mike Dunn got the win at 464, going to the finals for the third race in a row. David Reif, set up the finals for us.
Well, the pictures you are seeing on this camera will appear on Mike Dunn's website down the road at www.mikedunnracing.com. What they're showing is a guy who's going to his third final in a row, Gary Selzy, to boot. This is a big one for you.
I tell you, he's whipped us twice, you know, but hopefully third time's a charm. That Team Winston Dragster is awfully tough over there, but hopefully this Team Mopar Top Fueler can come away with the win. The last couple times we've smoked the tires in the final, I don't think you're going to see that. This track is really tight here, and I think you're going to see a good side-by-side dogfight.
Well, if Gary Selzy is superstitious, he might watch out, Steve Evans, because you know what they say, the third time is a charm.
Well, that man, Alan Johnson, and his crew have just performed an engine change in the Team Winston Top Fuel Dragster. Are you superstitious, Selzy?
No, you know, we did the same thing at Indy, but we smoked the tires. We're hoping not to smoke tires, Steve. We just want to race Mike.
The same opponent, three national events in a row. Unbelievable.
Yeah, it is unbelievable. And, you know, sooner or later, he's going to start wailing on us, and I just hope it's not today.
If you could design a race from qualifying through the rounds, this would be the one. This is how you would plan it.
The only thing we missed, Steve, was a national record, and we're not going for that now. We're just trying to get another win light.
Smart thinking. Bob Fry?
You know, it's interesting. Selzy running for the Winston Championship. Mike Dunn's doing well. Hasn't won a race this year, but in 1979, Rob Bruins won the Winston Championship. Never won a race. Mike wants to take Selzy out. He's 0-2 in the last two races, all in final rounds. Unbelievable. Laura Bird had a chance earlier in the day to sit down and talk with one of the great new stars in our sport, Kristen Powell.
For the third time in the last four events, Kristen Powell is celebrating a wonderful qualifying time. But Kristen, there were four events this year that you didn't attend at all. Was that part of the original plan?
It really was. We planned on running 16 races. It's gone on to 17. But we're just getting ready for next year. We don't want to push it too hard. It's a new team. And we're just trying to get me some lap time and get both Ray Alley and Mike Clover working on the car so they can get it consistent.
It sounds like you're focused on balance, too.
We really are. We don't want to push ourselves too hard. And I'm also doing school, which is definitely a heavy load for me. So it's just something where we don't want to get ourselves over our heads.
Tell me how much of an advantage you think it is to be such a minority, being young, being female, and racing this car.
Well, when it comes down to racing, I don't think there's much of a difference because men and women just race the same. But when it comes to media, we do get a lot more attention. I think that helps us with Reebok, Sequence, Chevrolet, and Royal Purple.
How proud are you when you get to tell people what you do for a living?
Oh, it's pretty exciting to be able to say I'm a professional race car driver. I've never been able to do that before, but up in Oregon, you know, they don't know about it too much.
You know, the one great thing about this sport, Kristen Powell and 24 other women have won national events. Don't forget, coming up tonight on TNN, you can stay tuned for a whole night of great hunting and fishing. It all starts after the Pioneer Keystone Nationals with Buckmaster at 6:30 Eastern right here on TNN. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have set the stage for you. We're going to take a look at the finals when we come back to the Pioneer Keystone Nationals at beautiful, quick, and fast Maple Grove Raceway.
180 miles per hour on two wheels, not your normal Sunday drive. Rather an open-air rocket ride side by side with your closest enemy. The bikes have battled down to the final pair. Who will win the 7-second war? We'll find out next.
Angel Sealing and the Team Winston machine is in the finals just like she was at Indy. And, wow, so is Matt Hines. The difference here, Matt Hines is the quicker bike and has been all weekend. Look at this. He took out Paul Gast, who beat him in the Pro Star race last week at ATCO, and to advance into the championship round. Meanwhile, Angel Sealing over Reggie Cole. Ryan Ayers, who had a pretty good weekend. And Steve Johnson, who went to the semis again and then lost to her just like he did out at Indianapolis. So this is going to be very interesting. Angel won her first race here in 1996, an emotional win that we will always remember. Angel and Matt Hines ought to be fun. Dave Reif down in the starting line. This is the race that folks came to see.
Exactly, Bob, and it might be a little closer than what we suspect. If you go all the way back to round one, Matt Hines ran a 7:32. Angel Sealing ran a 7:33. Team Winston has since kind of fallen off the pace, but George Bryce has found the problem, and they think that possibly they'll have a shot here. Steve Evans?
I'm all over Matt Hines here in any final run, for that matter. He has such an advantage over the field. He's calm, he's cool, he got enough races under his belt now where he doesn't get the butterflies. Matt Hines has taken that trophy back to Trinidad, Colorado.
It will be interesting to see if this one's decided on the starting line. They put a new motor in the Team Winston bike between rounds. Angel is 0-7 against Matt this year, 1-5 in final rounds. She is the only rider besides Matt to win a national event this year. Matt, other than that, has steamrolled through this class. And a huge round of applause goes up from the crowd as Matt Hines breaks on the line and Angel Sealing wins it. 7:35. You think she was emotional in 96? How about that? 180 miles an hour. And as the Team Winston ads say, why does a 100-pound girl drive a 600-pound bike 180 miles an hour? Because she can. Busted right on the line, Matt Hines, and Angel goes right down Broadway to get the win. Her second here at the Grove. First one in 1998, her second one in 98, but the first time she's been able to beat Matt Hines. This is going to be some fun at the end of the track, Laura.
Oh, and it is fun. Angel, how sweet is this?
I can't even tell you. I'm sorry, I'm crying. My team has been working so hard. God, come on, Gary. I've been waiting to win a race with Gary since last year, so let's go Team Winston. Thanks, guys.
And the fourth final in a row up against Matt. Is this a miracle for you?
Oh, man, you don't know. We changed engines before the final round because that last one just wasn't doing the job. And those guys kicked butt back at the track and had the trailer. And I just don't know what to say.
They took a chance, Bob, and it paid off.
The folks in Pioneer down there with the trophy and the congrats. I mean, Matt's going to win this. And that is basically a foregone conclusion right now. But not if Angel Sealing has a breath left in her 100-pound body. Dave Schultz went out early in this program, but he still holds on to the number five spot. Well, that could set the stage for some really exciting final round. So we talked to Kristen Powell, a female winner. Angel Sealing also won that 25 females to win in NHRA Winston Drag Racing.
You know, often I would try to make some kind of a prediction here, but I don't think I will, because if it was anybody other than Kurt Johnson, maybe Mike Edwards could leave on him. Kurt is so sharp, he is so steady on the lights, that I look for a good drag race unless Edwards gets too aggressive and actually red lights.
Well, Steve Evans, I talked to Mike Edwards just a moment ago, and believe it or not, they feel like they're struggling. It's just been that whole shot driving by the John Kite driver that has got them this far. Kurt Johnson, they've been slipping a little bit in second gear. They've made a clutch adjustment. This one should be a pretty good one, but I think it favors the AC Delco car of Kurt Johnson.
Edwards beat Kurt at Indy, and then he won Texas earlier this year when he beat Kurt on a hole shot in the final round. Your 96 Rookie of the Year, Mike Edwards. Let's give a lot of credit to Mike Elliott, the crew chief, unsung on this team, and of course to Mary Lou Kite, who keeps the legacy of her late husband, John, burning brightly with his Pro Stocker. Pro Stock Finals at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. Advantage Edwards out of the gate, but Kurt Johnson ran him down. Little payback from Indy, 698 beats Mike 703, 196 for KJ, just shy of that mark for Mike Edwards. But another sensational final round in pro stock, maybe the most competitive form of motor racing in the country today. Few hundredths advantage, KJ out of the box, or for Edwards, I'm sorry, out of the box, 500ths advantage for KJ on the track. You do the math. You want to see what 300ths of a second looks like after a quarter mile sprint at 196 miles an hour? That's it. Let's get down to the far end and Steve Evans.
Thanks, Bob. Before we do anything else, Russ Johnson of Pioneer, Vice President of Marketing, giving the gold man.
Hey, great job. Nice run. Nice run. Here you go.
Thanks a lot.
A 698, you didn't press the tree, you didn't take any chances.
We were just trying to get from point A to point B, but we're still trying to cut a 420 light. You know, Mike's tough out there. And I was laying in bed before I came here, and I told my wife, I'm bringing home the trophy. Here it is.
Move over, honey. I'm bringing him home. Bob Fry.
Congratulations to Kurt Johnson. He and his dad have earlier finished 1-2 in the Winston points, and unless somebody steps up and makes a statement soon, they're going to do it again here in 1998. Jaggy's number three, Jim Yates four, and that very tough Mark Osborne rounds out your top five, but a great final round in pro stock cars. Congrats to Kurt Johnson. Scusa wants to punch out that John Forrest. He's going to get a chance to do it. We got funny car finals coming up from the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. There may not be a more enthusiastic crowd on tour than the folks that have jammed into Maple Grove Raceway for this running of the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. Angel Ceiling, Kurt Johnson, winners in the pro stock categories, bike and car respectively. We're getting set to fire them up for the finals in Funny Car, Dean Scusa and John Force. Here's what it looks like when you burn out about 6,000 horsepower in your Mopar Matco Tools Dodge.
Austin Coyle is on record of saying John Force's car is a very good car when it's cool and cloudy, but unfortunately the sun has come out here recently. That has a tendency to make the Castrol machine a little slippery at the top end. That clutch lockup thing we were talking about earlier in NHRA today could come into effect here too at the 550-foot mark. These cars don't lock up until they get onto that asphalt, and that certainly could come into play here, and that might just favor the Matco Tools car of Dean Scusa, Steve.
I had a chance to stop by and talk to the guys, Ron Swearingen, Lance Larson, the crew for Dean Scusa. They are throwing everything they've got, more timing, more nitro, more blower. If that car hooks, Dean's got a chance. If it doesn't, Force wins another one.
Dean Scusa is 1-6 in finals. He won his sponsors, Matco Tools Nationals in Houston last year. We'll be there in a couple of weeks. 1994 in Atlanta, he lost the final to John Force. 95 at Gainesville, lost the final to John Force. Phoenix, 97. Well, you get the drill. That's his dad out in front. This is a great young driver with this team. Lance Larson, Ronnie Swearingen have done a remarkable job. They've been to a couple of finals here this season, looking to punch out the baddest dude on the block. This is the Funny Car Final at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. Ladies and gentlemen, Dean Scusa has finally exorcised the ghost of John Force in the final. Fine, a fantastic run. 503 beats Force's 511. The kid was first out of the gate. He never looked back. Dean Scusa punches out the gold car. And the kid that used to race a supercharged Fiat on the Midwest Outlaw Series takes out the baddest guy in quarter-mile sprint racing here in front of a capacity crowd. How about that? Dean Scusa wins it with a great 5:03. And the crowd, you got it, goes wild. And they should. Steve Evans, I'd love to be where you are right now.
Aha, Bobby. No, I wouldn't trade with you. I guarantee you they are dancing on the tables in the sports bars in the flats of Cleveland right now. As Dean Scusa gets the hat off, hey, buddy, gets the medal from Jackie Beck. Wow.
What a day. I mean, we overcame a lot. We had all kinds of problems, and my team stuck together. They're the best guys in drag racing. I know a lot of people say it, but I mean it.
And you went up there, and you didn't beat yourself. That's the key to this victory.
Yeah, we've had a lot of times Sundays off to think about it, and we have a really good strategy here. And, man, I think the car just sounds like a Jimmy Page solo when he's really on. You know, it's like a harmony that you can't describe.
That from a rock and roll drummer, Bob.
Hey, I thought it was a Don Costa arrangement. How about that? We're going to ride along on board. You will not see John Forrest. This is the happiest onboard camera shot that Dean Scusa has ever seen. Take a look at the points. Forrest still out in front. But, oh, baby, what a win for Dean Scusa. Captain Etchell still running for the Winston title. We got the finals and Top Fuel coming up, and that's going to be tough to follow. A funny car class that had given us Rick Johnson, John Collins, and Al Segrini gives us a win by Dean Scusa. Wow.
TNN's exclusive coverage of the 14th annual Pioneer Keystone Nationals has been brought to you by Mopar, Chrysler Corporation Parts, and the Chrysler, Plymouth, Dodge, Jeep, and Eagle dealers who sell and install them. And by Miller Lite, who reminds you that every Miller Lite is sold ready to drink.
And then there was one, the Top Fuel Final from the Pioneer Keystone Nationals, starting up the Team Winston machine to do battle with Mike Dunn and Darryl Gwynn's Mopar entry. Darryl is here this weekend, won this race back in 1988 and 89, and it's been a while since Team Mopar has visited the winner's circle. 1996, Memphis, the last time to be exact. Dave Reif, that funny car final's a tough act to follow.
Well, this one could be very good, though, too. Conservatism is the word for both crew chiefs. You remember the last time they raced just 2 weeks ago in Indy? It was a tire-smoking battle down the quarter mile. Both crew chiefs will tune these cars down just a little bit to try and avoid that again. Who has the advantage? Well, both cars have been in the mid-460s, but I think today's the day that the monkey jumps off of Mike Dunn's back, Steve Evans.
Well, actually, the last two final rounds between this pair, Brainerd and Indy, were tire smokers. I don't think that's going to happen. I also don't think Mike Dunn can quite run with Selzy. If he leaves on him, gets a whole shot of 300s or better, he'll nail him.
Mike Dunn's going to win this race, guys. It's fate. Angel won when Matt broke. Scusa beat Force. And a little while ago, a guy named Ken Montgomery won in Superstock. And why is that significant? He hadn't won a national event in 25 years. It's fate for Team Mopar. Then again, I could be wrong. Gary Selzy buries him here today. 463, 305 miles an hour. Mike Dunn smoked the tires. 653, 117 miles an hour. And there's the hottest guy on the circuit. Team Winston has won three in a row, beating Mike Dunn at Brainerd, Indy, and here at Maple Grove. And Team Mopar has probably got to be thinking, what do we got to do to beat this guy? Well, not this. Mike had him a couple of hunt off the starting line, but before they hit the 500-foot mark, he was out of it. Boy, look at Selzy. Yanked the wheels just like they want him to do in the Top Fuel car in the far lane. Dancing around a little bit, mixed up a couple of cylinders, but he's got the whole Top Fuel field mixed up over the last couple of races. We got a slow-mo shot on board. Team Mopar sees out in front for a while, but watch how fast Team Winston disappears when Mikey breaks. Goodbye. Wow. This team is hot, Steve Evans.
Well, you think the car was dancing around. Gary Selzy got out of this machine and did a flip for us with his helmet still on, and the beat goes on. Three in a row, the points lead.
Life is good.
Steve, life is good. Qualifying number one, Alan Johnson, and my guys had to change the motor before the final. Team Winston, NGK, Travers Tools, all these guys, man, I'll tell you, Mac Tools. What a day. You know, Mike is way overdue, and let me tell you, there are some first-class people out here. That's one of them, and God, I hope when he starts winning, he doesn't just beat us to death. But this has been a great day. Agnes, Mom, Dominic, can you say three?
Yes!
Little Dominic can count to three. Bob?
Wow, I love the emotions. Congratulations to Team Winston. Well, the points now, it is starting to get really interesting. We've got another leader in the clubhouse. Gary Selzy has gone by Corey Mack, who has led most of the year. Amato, look at Mike Dunn, just won't go away. Kenny Bernstein in the number five spot. Congratulations to Team Winston. They will go to the next race. Topeka looking for four in a row. Our high performer, our Mopar high performer, hey, Dean Scusa, took out John Forrest as if winning the race wasn't enough. He took out John Forrest to do it. Congratulations to Dean Scusa and the Matco Tools Car, our Mopar performer of the race. Don't forget, our next race on the schedule is the next race on TNN. It's Heartland Park, Topeka. Hope you'll join us for the Parts America Nationals. It's going to be great. Starts at noon Eastern, final round, a special NHRA today at 6 Eastern, all on TNN Motorsports. So the race that has given us wins by Garlitz, LaHaye, Gwynn, and Snake gives us Team Winston and Gary Selzy as they look for the second straight NHRA Winston Top Fuel title. And congrats also to Scusa, Angel Sealing, and Kurt Johnson as he wins it for the Johnson family. Sensational weekend, and thanks to everybody in front and behind the cameras that made it happen here at the Pioneer Keystone Nationals. From all of us to all of you, thanks for being with us, and we look forward to seeing you at the next stop on the tour and on TNN at Heartland Park, Topeka. ExperienceCountry.com, your personal source for all things country. From race cars to country stars, connect to country.com.